how to improve secure computation with penalties, right? So yeah, so I was going to start by talking about smart contracts, but it turns out the previous session was all about smart contracts, and you guys are probably tired about hearing about this, but I'll just say that what are smart contracts? They are self-enforcing contracts, to put it very abstractly, right? They are contracts that that provide guarantees, that say that, okay, if thing A happens, then it guarantees that thing B happens. And we are going to be interested in a specific kind of contract, which is exchanges, which is the concept of fair exchange, right? What is the problem here? Okay, this slide was not supposed to be here. I forgot to remove this. Forgot to show that, please. Okay, so what's the idea here? You have these two parties, right? You have Alice and Bob. Alice has this this blue document, and Bob has this red document. And they want to exchange these. Like Alice wants to get the red document, Bob wants to get the blue document. And you want to do this in a way that guarantees that the exchange is fair, that either both of them get the other's document or neither does, right? So you can't do something like say that, okay, Alice will first send her document to Bob and Bob will then send his document. Because you can, what if after Alice sends her document, Bob turns into this guy, and then instead of sending her his document, throws this cross at her, right? It doesn't work. So we want to come up with protocols which would give you these sort of guarantees, right? And we are going to model what we want in terms of this sort of idealized setting, and where we say there is this escrow service, there is this angle that is up in the sky, and you have Alice and Bob, and Alice has this blue document, Bob has a red document, and Alice has some specification. Alice knows sort of what she wants. She can check whether the document that she gets is what she was expecting to get, and which is what this fee over the other person. It's this fee is a constraint, a condition that the other person's document satisfies. And there's this angle in the sky, and both Alice and Bob send over their respective documents along with the specification for the other person's document to this angle. And once this fee is specified, the angle is acutely aware of what the other person's document is supposed to be, right? And so it checks whether the documents satisfy these conditions. And if both of these conditions are satisfied, then it just sends over these documents to the other parties. And it affects this fair exchange, where Alice and Bob started off with these things, and they were able to exchange this thing. So this is the ideal that we want to achieve, right? And one way to do this, obviously, is to have a third party which does this, which provides this escrow service, right? But we don't want to do that. We don't want to trust a third party. We don't want to incur the costs that would incur. And so we ask the question, is there some way to do this without involving a third party? Is there some protocol that the two of us can run which will affect the same guarantees, right? But it turns out that this actually cannot be done. And this was shown by Cleave in 86 in this classic result, that you can't actually do this without a third party. If you have just two guys and you want to do fair exchange, you can't. It won't be fair. But we still want to do something of the sort, right? So we ask the question, is there some setting where we can bypass this and do something that's useful in some sense, right? And since it's known that in the standard setting you cannot really do this, you have to move to a slightly different model, right? And what we hope to, and the model that we move to is based on this assertion that information has value to someone. Information isn't just something that's oblivious to everything else in the world. Like any bit of information means something to people, and there's some value. Like Alice has some value for the document that she expects to get from Bob, right? And we hope to use this relationship between information and the cost of information, the value of information to people, to come up with this different model, which involves money, where we say, okay, so Alice has some sort of monetary value that she associates with Bob's information. Bob has, let's say, the same amount of value for Alice's information, and they are willing to involve money in this arrangement. They each have this bag of money, and again there's this angle in the sky, and this time it's going to perform a slightly different action, right? So they start off by sending over their money and the specification to this angle, And this time this angle in the sky is not going to actually perform the exchange itself, but it's going to watch them do it themselves. So let's say Alice first sends over the blue document, and if Bob refuses to send over the red document, the angle notices this, it gives Bob's money to Alice as a penalty, right? If it's successful, then it, as compensation for not receiving Bob's document, the Alice gets money. And this is the sort of model we want to work with. We want to start by saying that people have people associate value with information, and they are willing to, even if they don't receive the information they expect to receive, they are willing to make do with some amount of money as compensation for this, right? And yeah, the deposit, the amount of money that they are willing to put in is like the value of the information. Now, like I said earlier, the reason we are trying to do this is because we want to get skirt the impossibility result, frankly, right? And in that sense, is this really any better? Is this something that we can do? Is this something we can work with? Well, it turns out that we can, in fact, do something in this model where it is actually possible to implement this notion that I just said. If you had a certain underlying primitive, which I'm going to describe now, and this is what we call the claim or refund transaction functionality, right? Where this functionality is as follows. So let us suppose that you had some way to do the following, right? You had some way to do the following set of operations, where you have Alice and Bob. Alice has the specification fee of of the information she wants from Bob, and she publishes somewhere. She says that if Bob gives me a document which satisfies the specifications, then I will give Bob this amount of money. Right? That's what the arrow represents. So Alice tells Bob, you give me something that satisfies fee, I will give you this bag of money. Right? And then if Bob does do this, then Alice is bound to giving Bob this amount of money. And let's suppose that we have something which satisfies this. And what if Bob doesn't refuses to give up this document? Well, Alice gets the money back. Right? Let's suppose you had some way to do this. Right? And the reason we are thinking of this is because it turns out there is a certain way to do this currently in a limited sense, but very possibly in a much broader sense as well. And this is using Bitcoin. Because if you look at taking away a lot of details, right? If you look at what you need to do to be able to translate Bitcoin into money, it comes down to something like this. Right? It's also this sort of this claim or refund thing, where the fee now corresponds to verification of signature, right? So there is the rest of the universe in some sense, the rest of the world in some sense says that if Bob is able to produce this signature under his public key, and this is going to be our fee. Our fee will say the document you give me has to be a valid signature under your public key. So fee will have this public key in it, and it'll say. And if Bob is able to produce this, then the world says, okay, here's your money, right? And so this is limited in the sense that you can only check, it only checks this one particular predicate, whether this is a signature. But turns out that there are other cryptocurrencies which let you do more, like Ethereum, I believe, for example, lets you do a lot more. Like, it can let you check lots more complicated predicates before you do these things. So this is sort of our inspiration for this functionality that was introduced. It was introduced by Bento and Kumaresan, I think the citation was in the previous slide. And this was the inspiration for this. And this is a point that you should keep in mind that will be useful later, that this fee, right, this fee is what is going to be evaluated by the people who are working on the blockchain, by the miners, if you were to implement this using Bitcoin. So these people would check this. So they would receive this red document, and they would run this fee on it and check whether it's satisfied and the thing. So this was inspired by Bitcoin, but it's not really dependent on Bitcoin. It's possible that all our results, right? So our results basically say that if you have some way to do this particular kind of thing, then you can do whatever I'll describe you to you next. And it's not necessary that this primitive is implemented with Bitcoin. I mean, it could as well be implemented by a bank. But whoever implements this, there turn out to be two important things that you need to talk about, which is the notions of privacy and scalability. They show up for different reasons, but privacy, for instance, is so when I said that Bob publishes this, so everyone else checks that this fee is actually satisfied on the red document. Notice that the red document has to be public for this to be possible, or at the least, it has to be revealed to the bank which is implementing this, if a bank is implementing this. So someone else gets to see this this red document apart from Alice and Bob, right? And this is not at all private, and privacy is something we would like. We would want this thing to be private. We would want no one else to know about the blue and red documents. Right? And the other thing is scalability. So remember I said that in the case of Bitcoin, the people who check the fee are like the miners, right? And if your fee turns out to be very complicated, then it's going to be a huge burden on the network, huge burden on everyone who's working on this. And even if it's a bank that's implementing this, this again costs more computation. We want to avoid all these things, right? So these are two concerns that we address in our work, where you want to take a protocol that does these things and make it more private, and you want to be able to make this very scalable in the sense that you want the fees that are involved to be rather simple, to be very easily computable, right? And so keep these two points in mind. We'll come back to this later. And now I'm going to describe, I'm going to start by describing a protocol that is already known for this, for the task of fire exchange that I described earlier. And then we'll see what we can do to bring in these two properties into the protocol, right? So what do we want to do? We want to implement this angle that is always right, right? So there are this thing that can, it sees everything and does everything. And we want to do this using, what do we have? We have this claim or refund transaction thing, which is what these arrows are, and we want to implement this. So here's the first attempt at this. So let's say the following is the protocol, where, so Alice tells Bob, okay, you give me something which satisfies this fee, and I'll give you this amount of money. And Bob tells Alice, you give me something which satisfies this blue fee, which is a specification for the blue document, and I'll give you the same amount of money, right? Ideally, what would happen is Alice would give her document to Bob and which satisfies the blue fee, and Bob would transfer his document to Alice, and they would each get the other's money, but they get the same amount of money that they put in, so they're both satisfied, and they get the information they want, and they don't lose any amount of money. Right? This is what would happen ideally, but this protocol is bad because what would happen if Bob decided to not send over his document? Well, but Alice has already promised Bob that if Bob gives her the red document, then he gets her money, right? So Bob could just simply not make the promise in return and claim Alice's money. And in this case, Alice has what she really wanted. She has the information she wanted, but she's lost money, which should not happen, right? A party which follows the protocol should not be penalized unnecessarily. And so we want to avoid this. Yeah, Alice loses money with exclamation marks. And this is how we avoid it. We use this this double lock mechanism. So this protocol again was in Bento and Kumaresan 14. So they do this. They say, okay, here you, instead of so what Alice will do, instead of just telling Bob to give her the asking Bob to give her the red document, will say, give me the red document and the blue document, right? Even though she already has the blue document, she asks Bob for the blue document, and we'll see why. And Bob asks Alice for just the blue document. Now, what could possibly happen here? The only thing that could happen next is that Alice turns in her blue document and gets Bob's money. But now Bob knows both documents, and Bob can claim Alice's money by sending over both documents, right? And this is how the protocol would work if everyone followed it properly, right? Now let's see what would happen if someone did not want to follow the protocol. Like, what if, for example, Bob did not want to make the promise? Bob did not want to deposit money and ask Alice for the blue document? Well, no, nothing can really happen, right? Because the only promise that has been made is Alice's promise, which to satisfy which Bob needs both the red and the blue documents. But Bob does not have the blue document, so Bob can't really do anything. What if, and Alice gets the money back, and. And what if Bob does the thing that he did earlier? Like Bob makes the promise, and Alice claims the promise by sending her document over to Bob, but Bob doesn't send Alice her document, right? So Alice does this. She should do it any moment there. So Alice does this. She gets Bob's money, but Bob doesn't want to claim the money. Bob doesn't want to reveal his information. But in this case, notice that Alice's money will go back to her because Bob did not claim it, and she has Bob's money as well, right? And this is what we wanted to achieve. This is the compensation that Alice has received for not receiving Bob's information, right? And this is what we wanted to achieve. And this is how this protocol achieves this. And so this is the protocol. And this is the problem with this protocol, right? So remember, I mentioned two points earlier. One was privacy, and the other was scalability, right? Privacy was where you did not want anyone else to learn about the documents. And this protocol is not private, right? Because like I said earlier, if you use anything in the claim or refund protocol, you are revealing it to everyone in the system. And you don't want to do that. And this protocol does that, so it's not private. Right. So how do we deal with this? Well, to start with, to be able to deal with it, we need something that gives you privacy, right? We have, currently in our system, there is no component which gives you privacy. And so we are going to bring in something which gives you privacy, which is the concept of secure computation. And we start by modeling privacy with this, again, this other angle, right? Which takes X and Y, so Alice and Bob are there, this is angle. It takes this Alice's input X and Bob's input Y, computes whatever function they want to compute, and tells Alice and Bob the answer. But does not reveal anything more about the inputs to either of them apart from whatever the result reveals. Right? Notice that this is the thing that we said is impossible. This is the thing that Cleve proved was impossible, that you can never actually realize this angle with anything in the real world. Right? Because even for this particular instantiation of this function, you cannot do this. Right? So what we are going to do instead is consider a slightly weaker notion of secure computation, which is where you have this, again, you have this angle, which takes X and Y and computes Z. But this angle is a bit obtuse in the sense that it doesn't guarantee that it will give both the parties the output, right? It just gives Bob the output, and maybe Bob tells it to not give Alice the output, and in which case it will not give the output. So this isn't as strong as the earlier one, as strong as the one which guarantees fairness, right? But it turns out that you can implement this obtuse angle using cryptographic means. We know how to do this. You have protocols which will actually implement this, which do not provide guarantees of fairness, but they do ensure privacy, that whatever happens in the protocol, Bob cannot learn Alice's output, or Alice cannot learn Bob's output, right? And this is what we will be using. We will use such a protocol. And how will we use it? Well, here's what we are going to do. So earlier, this is what we were doing, right? We had Alice and Bob, and they ran this the exchange protocol that we described earlier. The issue was that there was no privacy because everything was being revealed. Well, here's what we are going to do instead. We are going to start by running this secure computation protocol. What will this do? It will start by generating this blue key and the red key, these two keys, the blue key and the red key. And it'll generate them in an authenticated manner such that you can check that this is actually what it generated. And it takes the blue document, encrypts it with the blue key. It takes a red document, encrypts it with a red key. And gives Alice the encrypted red document and Bob the encrypted blue document, right? And gives Alice the blue key and Bob the red key. Notice that at this point, no one knows any information that they did not already know, right? Because whatever Alice has is encrypted. She does not learn anything about the red document from that. And she does not have the red key, which Bob has. And similarly for Bob, he has only the encrypted blue document, so he doesn't really know anything. But now what they do is now they define these new fees, these fee keys, which check that the keys are authenticated. Like earlier, we had these specifications for the documents, which were the fees. And now we have specifications for the keys, which are the fee keys. And you run the exchange protocol for these, right? In the same way, you do the same thing you did earlier, but you do it for the keys. And this, I claim, is now private because the keys were generated independent of the documents themselves, right? So they have no information about the documents. So revealing the keys to the public does not reveal anything because they do not have the encryption that actually has the information. And it's also correct because Alice and Bob have the encryptions, and so if they knew the keys, they could just decrypt their encryptions and learn the other's document, right? So that's why this is private. So we have whatever guarantees we had from the earlier protocol, but now we also have privacy. And I also want to claim that this protocol is potentially more efficient, because remember the fees that we had that they had originally, right, operated on the documents. They were specifications about the documents, and in order to be able to check that, you would have to read the whole document. Maybe the document is really big, and you don't want to do that, right? But the keys can be much smaller than the documents themselves, and the specifications about the keys, it could be possible to verify much more efficiently. Right. And that makes this a lot more efficient than running the protocol and the documents themselves. Right? So at once we have both privacy and scalability, because you can work with much larger documents without incurring too much more cost. Right? So this is the first idea. And it turns out that we can actually improve the scalability even further. Right? Let me tell you how. Oh yeah, before I go there, I have to tell you. So there are two separable aspects to this whole protocol, right? That was the part where they did the secure computation, where they generated the keys and where they encrypted the documents and all these things. This was done amongst themselves. Only Alice and Bob were involved in this. They did not involve the bank. They did not involve the blockchain or anything. Right? And this, and the cost of doing this, we refer to as the off-chain complexity, because it's off the chain. And there is this other part, which is the exchange protocol, which involves the blockchain and involves the bank. And this we call the on-chain complexity. And this, it's this on-chain complexity that we seek to minimize. So we want to make this more efficient. We want to make the fee case more efficient. We don't care as much about the off-chain complexity. It's still important, but it's not as important as this, right? And yeah, like I was saying, it turns out you can improve this even further by doing the following, right? So remember, so when they run the exchange protocol on the keys, this is what they're doing, right? But Alice tells Bob, give me both the red key and the blue key, and Bob tells Alice, give me the blue key. Right? And in order to run if you look at the validation procedures, right, you have to check that the whatever Bob sends satisfies both the fee k red and fee k blue, and you have to check that whatever Alice sends satisfies the fee k blue. Right? This comes up to a total of 3 verifications of fee. So you have to check the fee thrice on 3 different keys. Right? And now consider this alternate protocol, right? So this time Alice tells Bob, so Bob does the same thing. Bob asks Alice for the blue key. But Alice this time asks Bob for the XOR of the blue key and the red key. Where that is, you write down your key as like a bit vector, both keys, and take the XOR of these two. So first notice that it's sufficient for Alice to learn this information in order to be able to retrieve the red key, right? Because she already knows the blue key, and she knows the XOR of the blue key and the red key, that tells her the red key. And so she asks, and that's what the green fee key is. So the green fee key asks for the XOR of these two things, and Bob is supposed to tell her that, and Bob can learn that once Alice tells her the fee key. And Bob cannot learn that unless he knows the blue key, right? So this protocol still has the property as we had earlier. It's correct and it's private. But the on-chain cost is slightly lower in this case, right? It has, you are only doing 2 verifications now, right? And while this does not seem like a very big improvement in the two-party case, it turns out to make a huge difference if you go to the setting of more than 2 parties, which I will briefly talk about now, briefly, because I do not have that much time left. And in order to do so, I will need this slightly new notation where the thing in the bottom on the left is the same thing as what the diagram represents, where P1 is Alice, P2 is Bob, and P1 tells P2 that if you give me T, I will give you Q amount of money. There's also this amount of time tau, but let's ignore that for now. Let's ignore that for now. And T1 and T2 over there on the right over there, it means that P2 has to reveal T1 and T2. Yeah, that's what it means. And now I'll briefly tell you about what the case is with N parties. So what is the problem with N parties? You have these N parties. They each have their own document, and they all want to learn everyone else's documents, right? They want to learn everyone else's documents. You want to protect against the strongest possible kind of adversity, where just one party may be targeted by all the other parties. Well, all the other parties want to learn this party's document, but they don't want to reveal their documents to this party. Right? It turns out that there is a protocol that solves this problem that uses claim or refund. That solves the same, under the same model, it solves this problem, deals with this thing. And this is again by Vinod, Kumaresan and other people, and it's going to talk about this in the next talk. So I won't go into details about this, but it looks roughly like this. So you have these N parties, and they make all these deposits and so on. Where it goes like party one asks party N for all the documents and so on. I won't say anything more, but just notice that the number of the number of TIs asked for is a lot. Like each of the n minus one roof claims asks for n different things. And there are n minus one of these, so there are like n squared different things that you ask for, so n squared different things which are going to be verified. And in this case, you can use our ideas to bring this down to n, because if you do the, if you encrypt everything and do the XOR thing instead, each of those will collapse to just one verification, right? And that gives you a linear number of verifications. And that's all I'm going to say about that, because I don't have much time. And it turns out that you can do the same thing for a reactive functionality as well, where a reactive functionality is where you have several stages, and after each stage you get some kind of output, and then you have to make sure that no party leaves in between two stages and so on. It's not a priori clear that the ladder protocol works for this, but we can make it work. That's what the planted thing is about. And unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about this either. And the last thing I would like to talk about, yeah, again, you can use the ideas to make this better. And the last thing I would like to talk about is this. So very briefly, one other thing that we do is that we can come up with the protocol, like one protocol, for take any S and T, right? Take any S and T, like S is smaller than T, and S plus T is less than N. So I mentioned this other notion of fairness, right? Where everything is completely fair, that if everyone gets the output or no one gets the output. As I said, that's a pretty difficult thing to achieve, but it can be achieved in certain cases if the number of corrupt parties is really small. And what we can do is we can come up with one protocol which achieves both these notions simultaneously. That there's one protocol such that if the number of corrupt parties in the protocol is really small, then you actually get a fair protocol. But if the number of corrupt parties is larger than a certain threshold, but still smaller than a different threshold, you get fairness with penalties, which is the notion that I described. I would like to say more, but I cannot because we do not have time. So I'll finish with that. Thank you.
Anybody got questions? No questions? Last chance for questions. I was wondering, what is that phi for signatures? Did you write it out? The properties that have to be satisfied for the signature in your protocol to be accepted by the blockchain.
Could you elaborate? I'm not sure I understand.
So you can explain what that. How do you verify that this is? How does the blockchain confirm that it's a valid signature?
So Ido will be talking about that in the next talk.
Okay, all right, yeah. That's fine. Let's thank Prashant again.
Hey, can I have one? Sorry.
Yeah, so that is.
Oh. Yeah, I was just wondering if you could quickly summarize the contribution in the asymptotic improvement. If I heard it right, I think it was that for the roof and ladder, you go from either n to constant, was that right?
We go from n squared to n.
N squared to n?
Yeah, like the number of, we call this a script complexity. It's like the number of, the size of the circuit, you take the size of the circuit with the verification, and add up all the circuits over everything. And yeah, it used to be, so this protocol as it is n squared times some security parameter or something. We improve that to n times the security parameter.
Okay. That now matches the other protocol, the not the roof and ladder one, but the one by the other group? Yep. Summary of this paper in the next talk?
That's very helpful.
Okay, and then the other one for the dual mode one, is it that you reduce it from like n rounds to just f plus one rounds?
The dual mode thing wasn't known before.
Sorry?
The dual mode thing with these guarantees.
That's the one that I mean.
Yeah, it wasn't known before.
It was n before?
It was not known before.
It was not known at all before?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, thanks.
All right, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.